Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Today we have with us Dr. Vandana Prasad. She's a community pediatrician and a public health professional. She's been an activist in the social public health sector for around more than 25 years. And we are today going to discuss about the recent global hunger index that just came out and what are the implications of it, how India did as in comparison to other countries. So welcome, ma'am. Could you tell us what is this global hunger index and what are the parameters that we measured it with and the impacts and what is its significance for us?
Hunger and malnutrition are measured through various modalities, and as you know, there are national indicators and national surveys like the NFHS and so on that tell us about these things, and the global health index is one of those. A fairly recent one. We have three measures over 2000, 2008, and now 2016. And there were some earlier as well. It's quite a comprehensive measure. So it looks at the wasting and stunting amongst children and also under five mortality. So the significance of these are slightly different from each other, and maybe I can just tell you briefly what it means. So since stunting is an indicator of kind of an acute hunger or acute food insecurity, it tells us something about the short term. Wasting would be something about the short term. Stunting reflects more a chronic situation, so it tells us a little bit more about the chronic food security or insecurity. And under five mortality is a very significant indicator, in fact, because it's considered to be a kind of symbolic of overall development of a country, not just to do with children. In fact, all these three indicators, they function as a kind of a tip of the iceberg indicator. So they signify a much deeper, complex set of circumstances, which finally result in the malnutrition of children under three or the death of children under five. So it's very important to understand that this is nothing, it is not simply to do with the situation of children, but it's to do with the overall situation of development of a country comprising of many complex determinants, health, education, food insecurity, livelihoods, economics, water and sanitation, and coming to more proximal measures, facilities for care, gender, a very critical determinant. So it's a complex set of things that finally result in these indicators.
India has ranked pretty low. It's below Bangladesh and Sri Lanka and only above Afghanistan and Pakistan, which is not something to be proud of. So if you could tell us more about that, of that what that signifies and implies.
Firstly, this is not news to us at all. I mean, there's a huge amount of evidence that's been saying again and again over the years that India is continuing to do very badly as compared to its neighbors, and pretty badly as compared to itself as well, even though there are small advances. For example, in this particular index, in the year 2000, we were at 83, and then we, really went down to a terrible low of about 102, 103 in 2008, and then we slightly crept up to 97. So there's been a very, very tiny improvement from 102 to 97, but a drop across from 2000 to 2016 in 15 years. We've gone from ranking 83rd to 97th, whereas our neighbors have sort of crept upwards. So, and like I said, this is not a new story and this is not new evidence at all. There are many, many reports, there's much data to say that. And the reasons are pretty clear, because unless you invest in a situation, if there's no input, I mean, where do you expect to get outputs and outcomes? And very notoriously, the country has been grossly neglectful of the social sector in particular. So, like I'd mentioned, the two main issues here are food insecurity, which are further determined by the economics and so on. And the situation of health and healthcare, which goes beyond disease and illness and sickness to the social determinants of health as well. And the one other very critical indicator, which is gender, again, where India fares particularly badly. So if you're looking at investments from, malnutrition is understood, or malnutrition interventions are understood as being nutrition sensitive and specific, so or the causes can be considered proximal or distal. you know. So proximal causes would require making sure that children are actually fed, that adolescents are not anemic and so there's an intervention for them, that your Anganwadi system is working, that if children get diarrhea, pneumonia, then they are treated well. These are the closer to the issue, proximal kind of determinants. Now, there we failed quite miserably because, as you know, in the last budget, the ICDS budget was cut down by almost 50% and then slowly brought up a little bit, and in various states, the impact has been dramatic. So, there have been no payments of honoraria to the Anganwadi workers, the S&P supply has been disturbed quite a lot. The quality of food has always been in question with, you know, contractors playing a role, and the Supreme Court has been trying to get rid of contractors and so on. We've been arguing for better quality food such as eggs, for example, in the Anganwadis, but then politically, socially, culturally, there's been a kind of a protest against that, and, you know, that it's been claimed that India is a vegetarian country, which it is by no means. So we haven't really made that kind of an investment at the downstream kind of issues. And upstream, I think you know very well that unemployment seems to be on the rise, inequity, enormous inequity, very recent data, very alarming data that is saying that even in a country like China, for example, the growth rate of the lowest quintile is higher than the growth rate of the highest quintile. In India, it's the exact opposite. So in India, the rich are getting richer at the cost of the poor, and food prices have gone up nearly threefold. And of the food prices, what has gone up? It's basically pulses, threefold rise in, you know, in cost over the last few years. And so protein and sources of protein are now absolutely unapproachable for the poor. So how do we expect malnutrition to improve? So that's really the situation, you know, which we are in just now. Very poor public investments on all these fronts. And a very severe gross inequity. And in fact, now we have a very peculiar situation that the rich are also facing a kind of malnutrition because they're becoming obese. So we have a double burden of malnutrition in India, that the poor are highly malnourished. The urban poor are also getting obese because of this prepackaged food and, you know, these kinds of things. And the middle class is also getting fairly obese.
So when we talk about the public health sector and with this coming in of FDI, and so what is the commercial and political aspect in all this?
Yes, it's a very strange phenomenon that we're seeing. So like I mentioned, that we have a disinvestment on the public side. This is the case in health as well as in food, because I might also mention that we passed a National Food Security Act. This was 3 years ago. But we've seen no implementation, and there's no budget line really for that to go forward. We had talked in terms of maternity entitlements, which is another critical issue for the food security of young babies and breastfeeding and support to breastfeeding and so on. Again, there's been no advance on that front. So a refusal to invest more on the public side. At the same time, if you look at the, you know, the market, then there's another very peculiar and very significant trend that's happening, which is of allowing what we would call big food to come in as major players. So we are now anticipating the same problems that we had, for instance, with big pharma, except that pharmaceuticals are something that you know, are required as a company product, because you know you can't make medicines in your kitchen. But food is something that every household is able to produce and should be able to produce. So here, the influx of big companies making big claims of, for example, Horlicks and Complan have been around for ages, saying that your child will grow taller if you give Complan. At the same time, completely unwarranted claim, because if a child got a good, rich, balanced diet at home, then the child would grow equally well. So we are seeing this big influx, which also seems to have recent more and more government support, you know, saying that you use quick fix solutions of prepackaged food, which would have micronutrients and which would be labeled and so therefore standardized, safe. That kind of an approach is being taken to both malnutrition. And of course is contributing to obesity at the same time, because at one end of that spectrum is junk food. Then in the middle of that spectrum you have nutraceuticals, which would be these protein supplements, for example, for the elderly and even for children that are, you know, talked about. And then at the other end of the spectrum, we have therapeutic foods for malnutrition. So covering the entire, you know, ground of normal people, elderly people, young people, adolescents, and also malnourished people, in some way claiming that good food for this entire spectrum, I mean the entire population, can only come from big food companies who know better than, you know, a grandmother or a teacher or a person at home. And so that's really now a critical battle, that we need to reclaim these spaces, and we need to retain control over food. At the same time, make a critical, you know, value investment also, because it's not as though everything that was going on was fine. So we need to invest in a greater kind of food awareness, food education, but also making food available, because, you know, as I said, prices are making good food even more unavailable. The lack of control over forest resources is also, you know, making that happen, because in Adivasi areas, for example, a lot of the nutritional component actually came from forest produce. That also is now gone. Commons are gone. There's an agricultural crisis on. So at every end of it, from, you know, from the public's point of view, we're not gaining anything, and the public money seems to be routing through public programs and schemes, or at least there's an attempt to favoring big food. Yes, private players.
Yeah, you mentioned therapeutic food. So there's this new therapeutic food policy in Andhra that came. So if you could tell us about it.
It's important to note that we don't have a national nutrition policy that talks about how to tackle severe acute malnutrition. It's, the context has been severe acute malnutrition, a particular form of malnutrition. And we have been asking for the ministries to put forth a national policy so that it could be openly and transparently debated and discussed. Meanwhile, globally, coming from experience largely in Africa, there has been a fair amount of pushing also by the multinationals, WHO and UNICEF, for this particular condition of severe acute malnutrition to be dealt with through the use of patented company-produced products such as Plumpy Nut, Easy Paste now coming from Compaq, a country in India. There's been a kind of a move to spread these products into various districts and blocks. This move was countered some years ago, where the ministry said no to this kind of policy, but now recently has we see that it's happening in Maharashtra, in Rajasthan, in Andhra Pradesh. Very recently it has been announced. So slowly this seems to be coming up again. Now the major issue is again this, that the feeling is that just by distribution of a product, whatever that product might be, we don't really comprehensively tackle malnutrition. So we are looking for a much more comprehensive program that allows the communities to participate, that does not disempower communities, that protects livelihoods and the agricultural practice of a community, and the local produce is used and so on, where prevention is also, you know, part of the whole program rather than just curing children enough to save them from, you know, mortality, but then they go back into the same situation which led to the malnutrition in the first place. So we have been arguing for more comprehensive programs.
Why do you feel that the government is not making any public investment?
The only answer one can find for why a government steadfastly refuses to invest in the well-being and the growth and the lives of children, of women, of adolescents, of poor people, is that they just don't care. And I mean, there's no other answer that can be made, because there was a time when, you know, it would be said that India is a poor country, we don't have the money. Now we're a growing economic giant. Now where is the excuse for not investing in health, not investing in people's food security? These are our brothers and sisters who are, you know, languishing in malnutrition, where children are dying to the tune of, you know, hundreds a day, if not thousands a day, every single day. And a country and a government that refuses to take action.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving us your time on this. And we'll be coming back to you on this topic, and we hope things get better in the future. So this is all the time we have on NewsClick. Thank you for watching, and keep watching our interviews.